My mother spoke of grace with a quiet reverence, as if it were fragile as a soap bubble. Speaking too forcefully about it would make it disappear into thin air. Grace was not a word to be shouted anyway. My mother's belief was couched in doctrine. She quoted the book definition. It's a gift of kindness or good fortune, given not because you deserve it, but because you need it. I needed it. There was an aura of doom that enveloped our home, most strikingly at night, most nights. My father drank. In the middle of the night, he would waken us, shouting angry feelings he didn't dare express in the light of day, ranting about politicians who abuse their power, ranting at my mother. This was uncharacteristic of my father when he was sober. He was a kind and generous man. To conceal those tumultuous episodes, a dictum was issued. What happens inside our home shall not be revealed outside our home. Now, I know it's normal for children to think they are somehow accountable for what their family members do, to feel pride when things are going well and embarrassment when they're not. In this way, I was perfectly normal. But among my peers, I never quite felt normal. Maybe it would have been different if I could have accepted the peculiarities of our home life, like Marilyn Munster, who felt no need to conceal her ghoulish family's true nature. But when you're told to shroud your truth in secrecy, you can't help but feel like a misfit. Even within my extended family, upstanding citizens like attorneys, even a judge, I felt uncomfortable. But my Uncle Bernie was different. Everything about Uncle Bernie was big. He was 300 pounds and 6 feet tall, like a sumo wrestler, only taller. He loved life with a passion. Even the word my cousin used to describe him was big, magnanimous. The fact that he owned two of the three movie theaters in town was testimony to his desire that he loved to make people happy. He had a gift for knowing how to entertain. Every Saturday morning of every summer I can remember, he offered a summer Saturday extravaganza. My sister and I both went to it. She met her friends there, and I met mine. Everything about the morning was bigger and more exciting than going to the theater any other day of the week. The popcorn bulged inside large brown bags like oversized duffel bags, as high as Uncle Bernie's chest. One of my friends said it looked like the usual bags had been hit by gamma rays. And it was all free. The show was bigger, too. At least three cartoons before the main feature, and at least one afterwards. But the most exciting part of the morning was the drawing. Upon entering the theater, we were instructed to drop our ticket stubs into the large metal box at the entrance. Some of us even watched as the person behind us pushed his ticket in just to be sure that ours made it all the way inside. I think most of us gripped our half of the ticket stub in our sweaty hands as if it might jump out of our pockets onto the darkened floor, the land of lost opportunities. One Saturday morning when I was 10, Uncle Bernie came outside to greet us as we entered the theater. Now, he usually stood on the stage waiting for everyone to be seated, but on that morning, he stood next to the metal box. As I approached the entrance to the theater with my ticket, he took a step between the box and me. "Let me see that winning ticket, Donnie." Then he took it, stuck it in his pocket, patted me on the back, and said, "Good luck." I remember thinking, yeah, we both know I'm only here for the movies. Because of the misfortunes occurring in my family, I knew that good luck was what happened to other people. Families like mine were not winners. At best, my odds that day were 400-1 to win that prize. Now, that morning was the usual popcorn throwing, run up and down the aisle fun. After the last cartoon, as the lights in the theater got brighter, Uncle Bernie approached from the right side of the stage with the metal box tucked under his arm. Two or three ushers carried a large cardboard box up to the stage. It was obviously very heavy because they stopped a couple of times to get a better grip on the box. The prizes were always high-priced items, too. Bicycles, stereo phonographs, sporting equipment. Uncle Bernie grabbed the microphone from its stand and quieted the screaming kids, pushing down the air with both hands. He pulled one ticket from the box, paused, and looked at it again. And then he called my number. I had already turned my attention away, convinced mine would not be called. I didn't realize I had won until the boy next to me snatched the ticket from my hand and jabbed me in the stomach. By that time, the ushers had stripped away the cardboard and were starting to hold a stereo system with detachable speakers. Detachable speakers. Detachable speakers meant it really would have stereo sound. That can't be, I thought. My family doesn't win. But I did win. And in that instant, I felt like the world around me had changed the rules about what our family deserved. A few years ago, my sister and I got to talking about that fateful day. "Oh, yeah," she said, "that was great when Uncle Bernie rigged the drawing so you won that stereo." My pause on the end of the phone prompted my sister to ask, "Are you still there?" 40 years had passed, and I never knew. "He did what?" I asked. "You mean he cheated?" Now it was her turn to be amazed. "Yeah, you didn't know that?" "How could I have known that, Susie?" She said, "Don't you remember that he didn't let you put your ticket in the box? He took it out of your hand and stuck it in his pocket. Mom thinks he copied your ticket number and read your number instead of the number on the ticket he actually drew out." When I think about it, I can remember that he asked me to hand him my ticket. How much clearer could that have been? He never handled anyone's ticket. He just pointed to the box. That day, the odds against me weren't 400 to 1 after all. They were much, much greater. What are the odds of having an uncle who owns a movie theater, knows about the turmoil in your home, and decides to make you the winner of a chance drawing? Uncle Bernie knew I needed to feel like a winner, but I don't think he could ever know how much his gift meant. He made me believe for the first time that good things could happen for me just like they did for others. He inspired hope for more good fortune. Now, it's true that the stereo was a premium prize, but the real prize was grace. As a kid, I wanted to see what grace looked like. I thought maybe it flowed from some sort of celestial dispenser and only holy people were the vendors. But even a small town theater owner who uses his power with compassion is a person of grace. That day, Uncle Bernie gave grace a face. What better way to entertain a soul than to offer it hope?